I'm somewhat of a post-nuclear apocalypse genre connoisseur, it being my own personal movie catnip. I know it's probably going to be bad and 90% leather chaps, murder car chases and people getting handsy, but I can never help myself and I watch every single one I come across. So imagine my surprise when I found this week's film. So let's take a look back at Radioactive Dreams.
This is going to be a yarn about me and my pal, Marlowe. About the day we got out of the shelter and went off into the post-nuclear world.
Which is a 1985 post-apocalyptic science fiction comedy film written and directed by Albert Pyun. Radioactive Dreams is that most unusual of post-apocalypse movies. It has an uplifting message in the end, where after an atomic war, Phillip Chandler, played by John Stockwell, and Marlowe Hammer, played by Michael Dudikoff, who have spent 15 years on their own in a bunker, stuffed with junk from the 40s and 50s, with only old pulp noir detective novels for comfort and guidance, then asks us the question, what will happen when they take their naive 50s detective noir values in search of their fathers and wade through the stereotypical cesspool of 80s post-apocalyptic characters? And what a cast of characters it is. Firstly, we have both Marlowe and Phillip, with Phillip being far more downbeat and downcast about the outside world and the people within, being quite bitter and disgruntled that their fathers never returned to dig them out of the shelter and thinks they are probably dead. He also acts as the film's narrator. Marlowe is a far more upbeat and optimistic character, choosing to see the best in everything and everyone, and he is at heart an obvious idealist. The first of our cesspool characters are three hideous mutants chasing a beautiful young woman, which the boys save, and she is called Miles. She's the first of the two femme fatale dames to appear here, the other being Rusty, both tricking the naive rubes at some point. Miles by kissing Marlowe as a distraction so she can steal his gun, before we get to Rusty, though we are attacked by a group of biker chicks cosplaying as Cyndi Lauper. It is at this point that the boys discover the film's MacGuffin, a pair of nuclear activation keys to the world's last nuclear bomb, which is of course exactly what everyone in the wastelands are looking for and what Miles dropped in her haste in stealing the gun. Being the honest kind of 50s noir detectives they are, they decide to find Miles and return the keys. On the way, we bump into our second femme fatale, Rusty, who is being robbed at gunpoint by the disco mutants. Two foul-mouthed children, who are dressed like John Travolta from Saturday Night Fever and speak like they are auditioning for a part in the latest Tarantino flick. After they save Rusty, she agrees to take them to Edge City. It's at this point that we get a 10-plus minute diegetic needle drop when we enter a nightclub, and it's probably a great place to mention this movie's amazing soundtrack, which is a mind-melting mix of 80s new wave pop rock synth and swing, which is so awesome, I will risk getting a video copyright claim so you can listen to a bit. Guilty pleasure. All whilst this upbeat 80s pop rock is playing in the background, Rusty is of course selling out our heroes to a bunch of cannibals who happen to be dressed like Beetlejuice. Rusty turns out to be a swell dame in the end though and helps the pair escape the cannibals, although the boys no longer trust her, having tried to shoot her but running out of bullets, saying,
"That was a million years ago and I got a short memory. In fact, I don't even remember who you are."
When she apologizes. They in the end decide to use themselves and the keys as bait to draw all the gangs in to an abandoned warehouse where the gangs can then kill each other off in the crossfire. This plan goes swimmingly, apart from the fact the boys' fathers are in fact one of the gangs and are shot down and killed. With everyone dead, Phillip decides to abandon the angst he has carried with him for the past 15 years and adopt Marlowe's silver lining outlook on life, with the pair seeing out the movie with one of my burgeoning loves in 80s B-movies, interpretive dance. This time the post-nuke shuffle. Radio Dreams really is a strange mix where 50s pulp novels and an 80s lurid, florid neon post-apocalyptic nightmare are all combined with an eclectic, stereotypical cast of post-apocalypse B-movie characters with an absolutely banging 80s new wave sim soundtrack playing within and over the top. It really is great, dorky fun, and I can't say I have ever seen anything quite like it before, with the boys' idealistic values winning through the usual post-apocalyptic cesspool, with them uniting the warring gangs in the end by the power of dance and 80s new wave synth. There is only one problem here though. The movie got a limited theatrical release in September 1986 and grossed around $220,000, going on to be a success on home video, even winning a bunch of awards, but has until now never actually received an official DVD release, so it is in effect only available on VHS. Although it can be found in the darker corners of the internet, namely YouTube, if you don't mind the quality not being great. So that was Radioactive Dreams, a wildly creative joyride through the nuclear post-apocalypse seen through the prism of 50s pulp noir, and one, if you can, I implore you to track down.
A tight jam, a nuclear missile just might come in handy.
Next week is a Scream Queen-filled viewer request, so join me for that and like, comment and subscribe, and all that jazz, if you really feel like it.